Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Balanced Leadership, Making the Best Use of Personal and Team Leadership in Projects,
by Ralf Muller, Nathalie Drouin, and Shankar Sankaran.
Narrated by Lyle Blaker. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. This book is about contemporary leadership in projects. It adds two new perspectives to the leadership literature. The first is that of horizontal leadership. This occurs when the project manager empowers a team member to lead the project through a crisis or to solve a particular issue that the project manager might not be able to do. Once the horizontal leader is empowered, the project manager follows this temporary leader, but also governs the activities of the empowered leader. The second new perspective is balanced leadership, the dynamic and timely shift of leadership authority between project managers and team members to ensure the best possible leader at any point in time in the project. Together, these two new perspectives pave the way to a deeper understanding of the particularities of leadership in temporary organizations, such as projects. The listener will be presented with an overarching theory for balanced leadership, which is then broken down into its five events and their coordination mechanisms, which is called the socio-cognitive space. Three case studies are provided to illustrate the theory. The content of the audiobook is based on a program of many research studies, all contributing to the same objective: understanding balanced leadership. Dozens of researchers from all over the world contributed with their local studies to the global results described by the authors in this audiobook. 1. Introduction. Few concepts exist that have so many different definitions and are so widely used as leadership. Therefore, we should always relate the use of the term to a particular context. In this audiobook, the context is projects and their management. Projects are temporary organizations whose assigned resources undertake a unique and collaborated effort to deliver a beneficial outcome. Accomplishing this outcome requires leadership, which we define herein as an interpersonal, person-oriented, social influence to guide the resources in direction, course, action, and opinion. So, leadership is for, with, between, and about people. That makes it different from management, which is about tasks such as goal setting, planning, and controlling. Leadership in projects has been looked at for decades, almost exclusively from leadership theories derived from research in permanent as opposed to temporary organizations. That has given us much insight into what goes on between project managers and project steering groups, project managers and teams, within teams, and so on. However, it raises the question of whether possible particularities in leadership theory in temporary organizations have not been found because the research was mainly done in more permanent organizations. The research done on leadership in projects followed to a large extent the existing streams of either looking at the project manager's leadership or at the leadership that emerges from the project team. The former we often call vertical leadership, which is the project manager's top-down leadership over the project team. The latter stream of research looks at the different ways in which leadership emerges from the project team. In 2016, the Project Management Institute, or PMI, commissioned the authors of this audiobook to study the relationship between these two research streams in the context of projects. When we presented this project at conferences, our colleagues reacted enthusiastically and asked to join us. Within a short time, we were able to assemble teams in 9 countries, scattered all over the world, and at least 25 researchers who strongly supported us. A large number of publications resulted from this concerted effort and are summarized and brought together in a cohesive story in this audiobook. The authors and the country teams are still working on further studies and associated publications. By the time of writing this book, we have looked at many qualitative and quantitative studies, including approximately 80 in-depth case studies, around 300 interviews, global surveys with hundreds of responses, and so forth. It is fair to say that this is one of the largest studies ever conducted in project management research in general and leadership in projects in particular. During these studies, we found a great deal of support for the findings from earlier studies. However, we also found new leadership approaches, which had not been found in the leadership literature before. Before we start with these yet unknown leadership approaches, we first define what we mean by leadership approach and leadership style, and clarify which of these we will use in this audiobook. Leadership approaches. In this audiobook, leadership approach refers to the level at which leadership is located, or the direction where leadership comes from at any point in time in the project. By extending the research streams mentioned earlier, we distinguish between vertical, horizontal, team-based, and balanced leadership approaches. Within each approach, different leadership styles are possible. Vertical leadership is done by the project manager. It refers to the top-down approach from a formally appointed leader to the project team. It is the most traditional way of looking at leadership in projects. Earlier studies have given insights into project managers' preferred leadership styles, such as the transactional style over transformational style. Other studies revealed the psychological profiles of project managers regarding their intellectual, emotional, and managerial intelligence, IQ, EQ, and MQ, respectively, and the associated leadership styles. These studies revealed the significance of project managers' EQ for formal project success, as well as for collaboration satisfaction within the team. Horizontal leadership is a new approach found in projects. In horizontal leadership, the project manager empowers a project team member to lead the project temporarily. This becomes necessary because the team member possesses a particular skill set crucial for overcoming technical or other issues in the project that is not possessed by the project manager himself or herself. When the empowered team member takes on the horizontal leader role, the project manager starts to follow the temporary leader to solve the project's current issue. Simultaneously, the project manager observes whether the horizontal leader performs the task in the project's best interests and terminates the horizontal leader's assignment if that is not the case. The horizontal leader can apply a range of leadership styles depending on the project needs. Chapter 2 provides an overview of the popularity of autocratic, democratic, and laissez-faire styles in different project types and geographies. Team-based leadership refers to an approach where leadership emanates from within the team. Earlier studies addressed, for example, the emergence and visibility of team-based leadership styles, such as distributed leadership or shared leadership in projects. Team-based leadership and horizontal leadership are the main themes of the audiobook. They are enabled by the project manager, and together with vertical leadership, they constitute the main building blocks of balanced leadership. Balanced leadership is another approach observed so far only in projects. Balanced leadership is the dynamic and temporary shifting of leadership authority between the vertical leader, such as the project manager, horizontal leader, or leading subteams to accomplish desired states in the project. Earlier, we gave the example of a technical specialist appointed as a horizontal leader to lead the project through a particular issue or crisis. This shift of leadership is one of many different shifts in balanced leadership. Another example could be the need for a creative solution to a design issue found in a project. Here, a team of highly creative people might be needed. Appointing the team members as a leading subteam would be a typical solution. This appointment leads to a temporary team-based leadership in the project. The rest of the project team, including the project manager, is led by the empowered team. The particular leadership style, such as shared or distributed leadership, is up to the empowered team to decide. In other words, through balanced leadership, the best suitable leader is appointed for the project at any point in time. Figure 1.1 depicts some exemplary situations for balanced leadership to arise. The dark circles refer to the most likely leadership approach. Within each approach, various leadership styles are possible. Examples include projects for innovative new products. In the concept phase of such projects, the team members' combined creativity is required to come up with real new ideas and solutions. Hence, as shown in Figure 1.1, team-based leadership approaches, such as shared or distributed leadership, are most likely. However, if a particular specialist skill is required, leadership may shift temporarily to a horizontal leader. Similarly, in the planning phase, the project manager leads the planning team, but cannot be the number one specialist in all aspects of the project's scope. Here, a horizontal leader might be needed to clarify the types of technologies available for a particular part of the project and to steer the team to an agreed-upon decision in the project's best interest. Leadership styles. Many different leadership styles exist, and this audiobook is not meant to address all of them.
Instead, we focus in the upcoming chapters on those leadership styles that we identified through our studies.
These include transactional and transformational leadership, autocratic, democratic, and laissez-faire styles, as well as shared and distributed leadership. We briefly introduce them in the following. Transactional leadership builds on the notion of contingent reward. Here, leaders exchange things of value to the followers against a certain behavior or performance expected of them. It is often coupled with management by exception, whereby a leader mainly focuses on corrective criticism, negative feedback, or negative reinforcement. This can be done actively by observing followers for their mistakes in order to correct them, or passively by waiting until their performance goals are compromised. A study by Keegan and Den Hartog showed that transactional leadership is the most popular style among project managers. Later studies indicated that in complex projects, such as organizational change projects, more transformational styles are preferred, while project managers of simpler projects, such as engineering-type maintenance projects, prefer transactional styles. Transformational leadership attempts to develop followers to their full potential. Transformational leaders exhibit engagement with their followers. They use charisma, develop a vision, engender pride, respect, and trust, provide inspiration, motivate by creating high expectations, and model appropriate behaviors. Transformational leadership is often referred to as being based on four factors. Idealized influence. The leader acts as a role model for followers, who identify with and emulate them. These leaders typically show high standards of moral and ethical conduct and are deeply respected by their followers. Inspirational motivation. The leader communicates high expectations and motivates followers to become committed to a shared vision. Through emotional and symbolic means, they aim to have their followers achieve more than what they would if they were driven solely by self-interest. Intellectual stimulation. The leader stimulates the use of creativity and innovation, thereby challenging existing beliefs and values so that followers think out of the box and come up with new solutions and ideas. Individualized consideration. The leader provides a supportive climate and listens carefully to the needs of the followers. He or she tries to assist the followers through coaching in becoming fully engaged. Autocratic leadership is characterized by central decision-making by the leader, coercion, and a general lack of democratic processes. These leaders decide on their own without asking for opinions or suggestions from others. Their style is strongly related to the leader's traditional image as the boss. This style is often chosen for efficiency reasons, such as in high-risk situations. Angus Le Pen, Metcalf, and Ben maintain that these leaders show reward and punishment behavior, or rely on process and position to influence others. In line with English philosopher Thomas Hobbes, these authors argue that autocratic leadership is most beneficial in controlling selfishness in the commercial world, and that through their high level of control, autocratic leaders can effectively resolve and prevent social dilemmas. They argue further that autocratic leaders' voluntary teams show low levels of loyalty and high levels of fluctuation because this style wears down the staff. Democratic leadership is a participatory style where leaders value their team members' inputs and receive their commitment in return. It is appropriate for building consensus within the team, but might be too time-consuming to apply in cases of risks or emergencies. The approach might improve decision quality because it captures a broader range of opinions. However, even though these leaders seek input from their teams, they may not follow this input in their decision-making. Democratic leadership is one of the literature's preferred styles because it is seen as relatively more successful by behavioral scientists. It is one of the preferred styles of project team members. Laissez-faire leadership is characterized by the absence of leadership. The French word laissez-faire translates as let it go and implies a hands-off style which gives almost all decision-making authority to the team. Laissez-faire leaders abdicate responsibility, give little feedback, and do not attempt to help their followers grow. It is also known as a non-leadership style. Work planning, task assignment, and control in the project are mostly exercised by the teams themselves, making it a preferred style in cultures that oppose control, such as in micro and small companies and nations with low power distance. Shared leadership is different from the preceding leadership styles because it emanates from within the team rather than from the project manager. It emerges through a process of collaborative team interaction for the identification of an individual team member as a temporary leader. For example, to provide temporary leadership in solving a particular issue in the project. Team members engage in peer leadership by agreeing on one team member to be the leader. One of the requirements for shared leadership is the team's authority to plan and manage, which requires the project manager's efficacy and empowerment by the team's appointed leader. Distributed leadership is related to shared leadership, as it is also leadership at the team level. It is different, however, in that distributed leadership emerges from the discourse within the team. Instead of appointing one individual as a leader, distributed leadership builds on the team's collective brain by encouraging team members to contribute ideas to build a broad base of different perspectives and possible solutions to a given issue. The discourse on these perspectives brings out the agreed-upon solution or decision, which the team then implements. However, it is not uncommon in such situations that the team's boundaries become blurred, and individuals otherwise perceived as external stakeholders become involved in increasing the range of possible solutions and the resulting quality of the team's decisions. This brief discussion of leadership approaches and styles is not meant to be an exhaustive list. It is provided as an introduction or refresher for the chapters and discussions to come. This starts with Chapter 2, which provides a more in-depth discussion of horizontal leadership's nature and its application in construction and information technology projects on three different continents: North America, Europe, and Oceania. This chapter will also provide an overview of the preferred leadership styles in these projects and the nature of the decisions made by both project managers and horizontal leaders in delivering their projects. Chapter 3 outlines the theory of balanced leadership. It does this by informing the listeners of its underlying philosophical and theoretical lenses, and then describes the theory in terms of its five events, as detailed in the following: for balanced leadership, processes, the reasons for their functioning, as well as the limitations of its use. This provides a middle range theory, which is refined in each subsequent chapter through models that fit seamlessly into the overall theory described in Chapter 3. Chapter 4 describes the first of the five events in balanced leadership: the nomination of team members to a project. The variety of approaches for nomination and their popularity are discussed, as well as the tactics used by project managers to influence the nomination decisions made by other managers. Chapter 5 describes the identification of possible horizontal leaders, which is the second event in balanced leadership. Here, the nature of team leadership and required competencies of appointed leaders are discussed, as well as the ways to identify them in organizations. Chapter 6 addresses the third event, the selection and empowerment of a horizontal leader or a subteam. The different selection and empowerment concepts are discussed. A subsequent look at practices in projects identifies four different empowerment types, which, together, provide for a career development framework for future managers. Chapter 7 discusses the fourth event, the empowered leadership performed by the horizontal leader or leadership team and its influence on performance, together with the parallel process for the governance of the empowered leader or leaders. The differences between leadership and governance and their application in practices are also discussed. Chapter 8 presents the fifth event, the transition of leadership authority at the end of a horizontal leadership assignment. Using transition theory and realist social theory, the chapter outlines the processes and criteria for decisions regarding horizontal leadership assignments in the future. Chapter 9 addresses the coordination of the five events of balanced leadership in a socio-cognitive space. It outlines the need for and characteristics of the particular information that must be shared between the project manager and team for balanced leadership to occur. Chapter 10 is a case study of a project using balanced leadership in a public organization in Australia. It describes how decisions are made at different levels of an organization that have a bearing on projects, how the five events of balanced leadership interact, and how they are coordinated through the socio-cognitive space. Chapter 11 describes two large projects as case studies in Canada and provides an in-depth account of the ways the socio-cognitive space coordinates the leadership in these projects. Chapter 12 concludes the story and discusses the future outlook of balanced leadership. Summary. This chapter has introduced the concepts of balanced leadership and horizontal leadership, and has set them in relation to existing leadership concepts, such as vertical leadership and team-based leadership. It also has provided a short introduction to the leadership styles addressed later in this audiobook. 2. Horizontal leadership and its scenarios. The role of leaders is not to get other people to follow them, but to empower others to lead. Bill George. Introduction. The complexity of projects rises continuously as the pace of change affecting organizations increases. This situation intensifies the need to adjust leadership styles, and it becomes imperative for managers and project managers in these complex and changing environments to adopt more malleable and adaptive leadership approaches. As mentioned in Chapter 1, leadership style has been recognized as the driver in a project manager's rate of success or failure. According to Odukwa, Odetayo, and Sajwigbe, the leadership style of a manager influences the performance of team members as well as the motivation of the team to reach organization or project goals. Leadership is a social influence process in which leaders seek the participation of team members to reach specific goals. In addition, Nanjunde Saraswamy and Swamy determined that a relationship exists between leadership style, work satisfaction, and organizational commitment, which are essential for project management success. Therefore, it is important for project managers to develop leadership skills. In this regard, Muller and Turner determined in their research the need for project managers to be trained not only in technical and management skills, but also in the development of leadership competencies. However, the project manager cannot be a specialist and the sole decision maker in all areas from technology to business and strategy. Project managers must rely on team members and their specific expertise for appropriate and timely decisions for complex projects in a competitive market. Existing leadership theory takes a static perspective by theorizing either the leadership of a project manager as vertical leader or the leadership in a team, shared or distributed leadership, but not both in parallel. Table 2.1 defines various leadership approaches. Table 2.1, Leadership Approaches. Leadership Approach, Vertical. Definition: by an appointed or formal leader of a team. Leadership Approach, Shared, Distributed. Definition: a group process in which leadership is distributed among and stems from team members. Leadership Approach, Horizontal. Definition: executed by a team member upon nomination by the project manager or vertical leader and governed by the vertical leader for the time of the nomination. Leadership Approach, Balanced.
Definition:
emerges from the dynamic, temporary, and alternating transitions between vertical, shared, distributed, and horizontal leadership for the accomplishment of desired states in, for example, a task outcome or the entire project. In actuality, both types of leadership prevail in projects, but little academic work has been found on this phenomenon from the literature reviewed. As mentioned in Chapter 1, there is a need to investigate the balance between the vertical leadership of a senior or project manager and horizontal leadership of a team leader or team members, and the context in which the balanced leadership occurs to lead to project success. It brings us to the following question. How do horizontal leaders execute their leadership task in the context of balanced leadership? We were interested in looking at the nature of the leadership style when it is split between the project manager and the horizontal leader, and the nature of the decisions made by the two parties when executing their particular leadership approach. Figure 2.1 depicts horizontal leadership as positioned within the balanced leadership framework. In this chapter, we further present scenarios to illustrate how leadership is balanced in projects. First, we identify the circumstances that call for the empowerment of team members to become horizontal leaders for the good of the project. We will learn about the nature and the split of leadership styles across the two leadership levels, which helps to find a balance across the two levels. Second, we will learn about the types of decisions that are delegated to teams as well as those that typically remain at the project manager's level. Third, we hope to provide a more dynamic and realistic theory about leadership in projects, in particular, horizontal leadership, for new opportunities for theorizing. This includes the relative weight of leadership by vertical and horizontal leaders as manifested in their decision-making power, or their accountability as shown by the nature of the decisions they make. Horizontal leadership. What is horizontal leadership? We realized that, to date, there has been limited use of the term horizontal leadership. Since very few authors use this term, we decided to base our understanding on the most recent research on the topic, conducted by Muller, Jai, and Wang. Muller and others mention that some research has looked at leadership that emerges from teams or individuals in a team. This leadership complements the leadership of the vertical leader, and it includes, for example, the studies on shared leadership. Muller and others explain that traditional vertical leadership approaches are supplemented by approaches that include horizontal, and thereby collective leadership. The point here is to show that, in practice, leadership could also involve several individuals acting simultaneously, and that these actors do not necessarily have to be formal managers or leaders. Dennis, Langley, and Sergi identify four streams of research based on such a perspective. These authors talk about sharing leadership, or its related concept of distributed leadership for team effectiveness, an approach based on members of teams and how they together may lead, pooling leadership at the top to lead others, spreading leadership across levels where different individuals are involved in leading the project at different stages, and producing leadership through interactions. Leadership is thus viewed as a process of relational dynamics. In addition, Pretorius and others mention that horizontal leadership recognizes the distributed form of leadership in projects. It implies that one or several team members influence the project manager, and the rest of the team complete the project in a set manner. Because specific skills are needed at a certain point in time, team members become temporary leaders based on their skills and capabilities. They temporarily take over the leadership role on behalf of the project manager as vertical leader. The vertical leader is responsible for keeping the general vision and direction, encouraging the shift between vertical and horizontal leadership by including the team in the pursuit of solutions, and managing the fairness of the leadership assignments. Horizontal leadership is facilitated through empowerment by the project manager and is accomplished through self-management of the horizontal leader. Thus, horizontal leadership is practiced by a team member after he or she has been nominated by the project leader, or vertical leader. In addition, the project manager governs this leadership for the duration of the nomination and decides when it is time to pull it back to the project manager. The project manager may have several reasons for pulling it back. The decision is made when there is no longer a need to delegate the decision-making to a horizontal leader, when the horizontal leader should no longer lead the decision-making based on their expertise, or when the horizontal leader does not want to lead the process for various reasons. Figure 2.2 illustrates this sequential process model that starts in Quadrant 1, Qualification and Selection, with the qualification of possible candidates for horizontal leadership and the selection of a candidate when the need for horizontal leadership arises. In Quadrant 2, Enabling, the vertical leader appoints or grants the authority to one or several horizontal leaders. The horizontal leader therefore has the opportunity to develop self-management capabilities. Quadrant 3, Exercising Horizontal Leadership, makes visible the leadership by the horizontal leader, namely the vertical leader's handover of leadership authority and the acceptance of it by horizontal leaders. Finally, in Quadrant 4, Monitoring and Control, once the horizontal leader has taken over, the vertical leader's monitoring and control of the horizontal leaders sets in. Chapter 1 has covered the variety of leadership styles cited in the literature. We will not repeat this here, but we'll summarize some key points that will be used in this chapter. For instance, Frame proposed three basic leadership styles: autocratic, laissez-faire, and democratic. Autocratic leadership is associated with the traditional image of the manager as the boss and is associated with highly centralized decision-making. Laissez-faire lies at the other extreme. When this style is adopted, nobody is in charge, and the project members decide by themselves. A laissez-faire approach might be used by project managers to encourage creativity in team members. A democratic style is a participative approach. Democratic leaders value team members' inputs to be included in decision-making processes. It is important to understand the leadership style of our vertical leaders, since it could have an impact on the delegation and empowerment of the horizontal leader. It is also important to identify the nature of decisions that are delegated to the horizontal leader. These will be further discussed in the scenario section. Nature of decisions. Every project has decisions that are made at different hierarchical levels, with the responsible actor operating in a certain number of fields of action corresponding to certain decision types. Decisions could be characterized as unstructured or complex. Although the concept of a decision remains ambiguous and ill-defined, decisions could be classified under various types: strategic, non-strategic, organizational, operational, or according to their specific nature, whether they involve commercial or economic matters. For Mintzberg, Razinghani, and Theoret, strategic decisions are seen as large, expensive, and precedent-setting, producing ambiguity about how to find a solution and uncertainty in the solution's outcomes. Mintzberg categorizes decisions using the five P's as follows. Plan. The decision is an intended course of action carried out with a clear purpose. Ploy, which has a military root, refers to decisions as a set of actions to outwit the competition. Pattern. Decisions are not made with a clear planned purpose, but exhibit similarities to each other. Position. A decision is meant to realize a match between the organization and the environment. Perspective. Decisions are a reflection of how strategists in an organization perceive the world and their organization. At the project level, strategic decisions are important because they may affect the objectives and project goals. For the purpose of this chapter, these strategic decisions are defined as strategic and political decisions that involve, for instance, the budget allowance, management of political issues within the organization, business management decisions that affect the overall logic of the firm's bundle of services and markets, the administration of contractual agreements, key human resource policies and resource allocation, and finally, the governance structure. For example, the selection and development of project management practices. These strategic decisions deal with overall project effectiveness and adequate resource utilization so that the organization can obtain expected benefits. Tactical or operational decisions relate to the day-to-day functioning of the project. These tactical decisions require a lot of inputs to establish an efficient vision of the project, making certain that project goals are pursued as planned. For example, solving technical problems, fine-tuning project planning. These decisions are related to technical decisions that are usually made by an expert. Stakeholders management, the daily tasks attached to the management of the project, and changing or unforeseen events that occur throughout the life cycle of the project. These decisions, which are more task-oriented, are usually under the responsibility of the horizontal leader. According to Zabonik, it may be optimal to let workers decide how to do their jobs, even though managers may have better information. Zabonik further argues that decentralization of decisions is recommended when quick responses to changing technologies and environments are required, and new information flows upward through the hierarchy. Decisions could be made by an individual or by team members as a group. Examples of scenarios using case study descriptions. To illustrate some scenarios, the following section describes case studies with Canadian, Scandinavian, and Australian firms. The firms and their specific projects are described in boxes 2.1, 2.2, and 2.3, followed by a discussion of the scenarios for balanced leadership. Box 2.1. Canadian cases. Utilities. Project 1, Canada, is worth around 500 million Canadian dollars and involved the rehabilitation of the intake and spillway at a generating station. This undertaking was intended to ensure long-term facility operability. The project took 10 years and involved at its peak a dozen people from the company, plus external stakeholders such as contractor teams. The on-site team was led by a senior manager in charge of a portfolio of five major projects in a specific geographical region. The senior manager reported directly to his immediate superior, who was based at the headquarters of the company. The project manager was responsible for all project-related activities and reported directly to the senior manager. The security advisor was a team member in charge of the construction safety and relations with the contractors. The on-site engineer was accountable for all mechanical and technical engineering issues and reported directly to the project manager and frequently collaborated with the engineering division based at the headquarters. Finally, the clerk was mainly in charge of buying equipment that supported the management of the teams and on-site facilities. External stakeholders were mostly contractors, three or four depending on the phase of the project, and the team of the turbine manufacturer. The Canadian company leading this project is a world leader in the field of hydroelectricity. It focuses on the refurbishment of generating and transmission hydroelectricity facilities to meet the needs of its clients. Construction, public sector. Project 2, Canada, involved the construction of a sports stadium. With an allocated budget slightly over 50 million Canadian dollars, the stadium had to house both an indoor and an outdoor field. The building of a state-of-the-art sports stadium was the result of an election promise several years prior to its formal authorization. The completion of Project 2 stretched over 8 years and involved an architectural contest to select a design that would become a symbol of creativity and innovation. Initially under the sole charge of the city's sports department, the project was later carried out jointly with the property planning and management department, as the latter was more experienced in the fields of project management and infrastructure construction. Operating under a matrix structure, Project 2 was supervised by senior managers from both departments, who were also in charge of other projects and programs simultaneously. Under their authority, two project managers were assigned full-time to the project, one each from the two departments involved. The project manager attached to the sports department was mainly in charge of communications, public relations, and fostering relationships with sports associations, while the project manager from the property planning and management department was assigned to oversee the activities related to the planning and the building of the infrastructure. When the construction phase began, an on-site engineer and on-site assistant junior engineer were added as full-time members of the project team to monitor the construction site and ensure compliance with contracts. As for external stakeholders, the primary parties were the architectural firm, chosen through the contest, and the building contractor, selected following a call for tender. A steering committee was formed in order to facilitate collaboration between the core project team and other stakeholders, such as representatives from other internal departments, sports associations, municipal regulatory bodies, and energy service providers. The organization commissioning the infrastructure project is a municipal government administering an urban city that has over 1 million inhabitants. Box 2.2. Scandinavian cases. Professional services. Project 3. Scandinavia. The organization plans, builds, operates, and maintains roads in Scandinavia. It is more than 150 years old and a highly multidisciplinary organization of about 7,500 employees, including a wide range of analysts, engineers, and other skilled workers. This organization runs a large number of projects of varying size at any point in time. The unique geography and climate in Scandinavia present a number of challenges to road construction projects, such as subsea tunnels, long tunnels, and advanced bridge constructions. The case study was done on four large road construction projects in northern Scandinavia. In addition to the typical project execution processes that are widespread in infrastructure development projects, the focal projects contain a large number of stakeholders and are highly infused with local and regional political issues. The interviews were conducted with two senior managers, as well as project managers and project team members of a wide spectrum of projects. Engineering. Project 4. Sweden. The organization is a global engineering corporation with more than 130,000 employees. Its focus is on development of technologies in the automation and power industry, for which it develops and supports a broad range of products and services. The organization maintains a global network of corporate research centers for the development of technologies for future products and services. The case study was done on one of these centers. Here, the focus of activities is very broad and covers technology development for automation, environment, machines, and new materials, as well as underlying services and processes, such as those for software architecture and processes.
The research center does this by monitoring the market to identify opportunities for technologies needed for development, developing these, and then transferring them to the business areas of the wider corporation, where they are used in and for products. The employees in this center are typically engaged in collaborations with universities and other research centers, internal and external to the corporation, and, to a lesser extent, with customers and their specific projects. The interviews were conducted with a senior manager, as well as project managers and project team members from a wide spectrum of projects. These include engineering and engineering studies, technical research and development, or R&D, and IT projects. Box 2.3. Australian cases. Construction, private sector. Project 5, Australia, is the IT department for a major international property and infrastructure group employing more than 12,000 people. Its business covers managing projects over their life cycle, including coming up with new ideas. It also invests in development projects and participates in construction. The IT department was mainly focused on solutions for internal departments like human resources, finance, and property development, in helping to deliver technologies for business operations. There were two project teams managed by two delivery managers delivering close to 15 projects at any one time. The teams used both waterfall and agile methodologies, depending on the context in which the project was carried out. Financial services. Project 6, Australia, is a major financial services company in Australia, with close to 100 billion Australian dollars in assets and employing more than 15,000 people. Its business service is in banking and several types of insurance and wealth management. The people interviewed at this organization were part of a major business transformation IT-based project that was carried out over 2 years and estimated to cost more than 300 million Australian dollars. The project was carried out in collaboration with a major technology partner and employed close to 600 people at its peak. Work was also outsourced to offshore service providers, but was managed centrally from Australia. The project was aimed to increase efficiency, speed up transactions, and make better use of business intelligence. The major methodology used by the organization was agile due to its heavy IT emphasis. While the organization did not use a large-scale project management office, the project was supported by sponsors from technology and business.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.